This is that part where it tells me it's setting up my meeting for Facebook Live. And I think I'm not live yet. And then when I look back at the video later, I'm quiet for like a minute and I'm staring at the screen. And I need to get back in here. So I am trying my best. What's my live thing? I am live. If I hit this, I come back to where I want to go. I would like for today's Tea and Notebook Tuesday, which hi, welcome to Tea and Notebook Tuesday. I am trying to add a poll, but Facebook is surprisingly difficult with this. For no reason I can figure out. Why are you doing this to me? And I don't know if I've been able to start the poll or not. Yes, but in 2021, I'm planning on, or I can, change the time of Tea and Notebook Tuesday to whatever works for you guys. So I'm trying to set up a poll where you can tell me what time on Tuesday you can watch the show live, and I'll change it to whatever works for everybody. Don't know if I was able to set up a poll. Matter of fact, I think I kind of didn't, because Zoom and Facebook Live can only do so much together. I don't know, it's fine, I'll figure it out. So if we're not voting on this video, I'll end up adding it to the next video. I'll figure out how to do it from there. And you'll pick between like 11 o'clock, which is what we're doing now, noon. I think I could do it as late as 5 p.m., but I could also do it at 4. So let me know what your preference is. Let's start off with our slides. Let's go over here. Share to this, to this. I don't want that. I want that. There we go. All right. Welcome to Tea and Notebook Tuesday for December 15th. Today we're going to talk about romance novels and what I'm calling Women of the World, which is a women-centric nonfiction. I'm drinking my tried and true Tazo vanilla bean macaron. Although Republic of Tea has a vanilla almond that's really good. I don't usually buy it, but my mother does, which means I get to drink it a lot. And the thing I'm really excited to share with you is that we are doing a drive-in movie. This is our screen. We didn't have any bananas, so we added a Lisa and a Jasmine for scale. It will be this Thursday. We're going to show Home Alone. It starts at 6 o'clock. So if you would like to bring your bubble, whoever you're in your bubble with, whether it's your family or your roommates or whatever, whoever you're safe to be unmasked around, put them in the car and bring them down to the library for a socially distanced event. Yeah. All right. So what I'm reading. I gave up on Ready Player 2 because something happened to me that happens a lot with books that I'm just not into enough, which is about halfway through, my brain starts to chant, I don't care, I don't care. And as I'm reading, which is distracting and also the signal for my brain that I'm just not into this enough to continue reading it, which happened to me with Ready Player 2. Also, it was due and there was a hold on it, so I had to return it. So now I've read a few chapters of The Wife Upstairs, and I've read a little bit of Cook, Eat, Repeat by Nigella Lawson. The Wife Upstairs comes out January 5th. So far, relatively basic, but pretty interesting. I don't know if I'll end up finishing it, but we'll see. I'll just keep going and see if my brain chants, I don't care. I am very likely to finish Cook, Eat, Repeat because I've read several of Nigella Lawson's cookbooks. I own like half a dozen of them. Like I own a lot of them and I just love her. If you've heard of the sort of viral, controversial in like a silly way, clip of her pronouncing the word microwave, I think she was kidding. If you haven't, Tell me what you think in the comments. It's possible she's being ironic, maybe. But if you haven't heard this, Google Nigella Lawson microwave. It's good for a laugh. All right, our giveaways today are two books that are romance or romance adjacent, beginning with The Other Bennett Sister, which I have a totally different cover than this one, but this is an ARC, so sometimes they have different covers, by Janice Hadlow. The Other Bennett Sister is about Mary Bennett, the character from Pride and Prejudice, who's very awkward and kind of the ugly duckling of the Bennett family. This is about her, emerging from the shadows and becoming a woman who is desired and has choices of her own, which I thought sounded interesting. The other book I'm giving away is The Wrong Mr. Darcy by Evelyn Lazda and Holly Lawrence. Sorry if I mispronounce those names, but that kind of always happens. This is a retelling of Pride and Prejudice, and it's set in the sports world. So our Miss Bennett this time is a sports journalist. It's very ambitious. And the rookie on the rise is her Mr. Darcy. He's a rookie in basketball. That's what I was saying. Yes. So if you'd like to win either The Other Bennett Sister or The Wrong Mr. Darcy, type "I want to win" in the comments and give me your preferred MPL location for pickup. I will be choosing our winners on Friday, the 18th. So it closes at 9 a.m. All right. Yeah. And we're moving on to our romance novels, some of which look really complicated and interesting, which I always like. This one just looks like fun. It's called Joint Custody by Lauren Baratz Logstead and Jackie Logstead. It is about, they're calling it a romance for dog lovers. Its main character is Gats, the dog. Gats knows that his man-human and his woman-human belong together, but they're never together. Now he lives with the man-human all week long, and then he gets to live with the woman-human on the weekend. He's willing to do anything to bring them together, including, I think, eating a bunch of chocolate, even though he knows he shouldn't. For those of you who don't know, chocolate is toxic to dogs. So he's taken matters into his own paws because he's determined. It's described as laugh out loud, funny, and offbeat, both of which, you know, can be good if they're well done. There's no early reviews yet, but if you're interested in Joint Custody, it comes out on January 5th. All right. Shipped. Okay. For a second, I thought this was another rewrite of an Austen novel, but it's not. Shipped is about Henley. She's our heroine in this novel. She is getting her MBA at night and working really hard at a cruise line during the day. She really wants this promotion, but her main rival for it is the social media manager, whose name is Graham, but the name is spelled G-R-A-E-M-E, which I kind of hate. But I'm going to forgive the author because sometimes they have to come up with unique spellings for books for some reason. I don't know. They just do. Anyway, their boss decides that they should each draft a proposal for a marketing campaign for their cruise line that goes to the Galapagos. And in order to write the campaign well, they need to go on the cruise to the Galapagos. Whoever writes the best campaign is going to win the job. So this is the first time they've actually spent time together in person because Graham works remotely. And Henley soon realizes that the difference between liking and loathing is as thin as a postcard. This is the author's first novel. The 300 early reviews gave it a solid 4-star rating. So if you want to try out a new author and what looks like an interesting title, Shipped comes out January 19th. All right. The Jake Ryan Complex. This one I was immediately drawn to because I think they've done the silhouette really well on the cover. And also, I know exactly who they mean. Jake Ryan is the love interest from 16 Candles. In this book, our Chicago-based heroine is in love or fell in love with a fictional Jake Ryan when she was a teenager and is content to spend decades waiting for a real life equivalent. her mother is a little more impatient and feels she should, you know, get on with meeting people and whatnot. So she starts lying to her mother and saying that she's dating a doctor named Michael. Then her sister gets engaged, and now she's expected to bring the non-existent Michael as her plus one to the wedding. So she's got to find herself a flesh and blood stand-in. So it's one of those sort of romantic comedy setups. This is Campbell's, or at least Crandall's, first novel, or first adult novel. I'm sorry, she's written children's stuff. And the handful of early reviews give it a solid 3.5 stars. If you're interested in the Jake Ryan complex, it comes out January 26th. All right. Shelley Shepherd Gray started a new series. The first book is called A Perfect Amish Romance. It's going to be the Berlin Bookmobile series. So I think this is going to be rooted in this bookmobile driver being a little bit of a matchmaker in the Amish community. So Sarah, the bookmobile driver, has an Amish patron, a young man who is studying for his GED, but secretly, and he asks for some study material, and she does him one better and finds a young woman who can tutor him. The young woman is losing herself in romance novels and has secrets of her own that she has to deal with. One of the published reviews pointed out that Shelley Shepherd Gray is a best-selling author who reminds the reader that faith can help us survive the ups and downs of life. Not really enough reviews for me to give you any stars on this exact title, but Shelley Shepherd Gray is often in the 4-star range. If you're interested in the very first Berlin Bookmobile book, A Perfect Amish Romance, it comes out January 19th. All right. This is one I might end up reading, or at least I'm interested in. This is book 2 in a series. I usually try to add the first book in the corner, and I downloaded it and got ready and then forgot. The first book is called The Vanishing, and this is the Fog Lake series. I don't know how long the series is going to be, but it looks like a planned out series based on the way the story is constructed. So these first two books have different protagonists in each of them, but they take place in the same town, Fog Lake. 40 years ago in Fog Lake, there was an explosion in a cave and a gas was emitted. After that, the town's residents started like seeing visions and hearing voices. They didn't want to get the government involved, so they just chalked it up as like weird hallucinogenic mushrooms must have been destroyed in the explosion and caused this to happen. But decades later, the town still has multiple psychics who are legit psychic. And it's probably the after effects of this explosion. They still don't know what happened. And I think based on the way it's described, this is what they're gonna do for the whole series. There's an individual mystery for each book. I'll get into the individual mystery for All the Colors of Night in a second. But there's also the overarching mystery of what happened 40 years ago. Why did that explosion go off? And what came out of those caves that caused everyone to develop psychic powers? So as each individual protagonist in each book is looking into secrets and lies and all of the things that are involved in a mysterious investigation, they're getting clues and finding out things more about what happened 40 years ago. So while the characters in the novel are investigating one mystery, the reader is getting more information about a larger mystery that is going to take place over the course of the whole series. That's why I think it's a planned series, because I don't see how she could figure this out book by book. Like, it takes a pretty skilled hand to do it, and Jane Ann Krantz is a well-known, respected author with, you know, New York Times bestseller and all that good stuff. So I think it could work in her hands. All the Colors of Night is about a psychic protagonist, which the first one is too, but she's trying to figure out why her father suddenly fell into a coma, and she thinks it might be related to a secret government project from years ago. And I'm betting the secret government project relates to the initial explosion. The Vanishing is already out, obviously, because it's the first book. It's available at most branches. I think it's available at every branch. And we also have the large print if you want that. But All the Colors of Night, which is book two in the series, comes out January 5th. All right. I'm going to move on to nonfiction, and I'm going to get some tea. Oh, yeah. Here we go. All right. The Last Queen, Elizabeth II's 70-year battle to save the House of Windsor by Clive Irving. This is obviously a biography of Queen Elizabeth II, clearly. But Irving is an investigative reporter, and the material on the book is basically saying that he's lending a fairly critical eye to this biography and coming at it in a way most biographers don't. He's also described as highly involved with the British royal family. No idea what that means, nor do they bother to explain it. Irving has also said that the Queen has been able to hold up the fragile institution with, you know, consistent, dutiful service, but also by, and I quote, making a Faustian pact with the media. That's the line that struck me as really interesting. The description does not explain it any more than that. Faust is a reference people throw around a lot. It's actually a German legend. And it became books and plays and movies and all sorts of things. But it's almost, when you see something as Faustian, it's almost always a person who sacrifices their morality or their conscience for the sake of forward advancement towards whatever they're ambitious about. So saying that about the royal family's relationship with the media is really interesting to me. And I would like them to have explained it more, but obviously they wanted to use that to get me to read the book. I kind of doubt that I'll have this much time for a nonfiction title, but we'll see. I'll put it on my to-be-read list and we'll see what happens. But if you're interested in The Last Queen, it comes out January 5th. All right. White Feminism, From Suffragettes to Influencers and Who They Leave Behind by Coa Beck. Beck in this book blends pop culture, primary historical research, and firsthand storytelling, so her personal experience, to show us how we have shut women out of the women's movement and what we can do to course correct for the future generations. It's described as witty, whip smart, and profoundly eye-opening. It's challenging long accepted conventions and completely upends the movement and the way we understand the struggle for women's equality. It's described as perfect for fans of white fragility and the book Good Man. And Beck she was the editor-in-chief of Jezebel. I don't think she has a ton of other credits to her name. And of course, I don't have any reviews because it's nonfiction. There are rarely any reviews for that. But if you're interested in it, it comes out January 5th. All right. With Her Fist Raised, Dorothy Pittman Hughes and the Transformative Power of Black Community Activism. This is the first biography of Dorothy Pittman Hughes, which is always interesting because I find the biographies I like the most are the ones where I knew the least about the person the biography was about. Because then everything's a surprise. Just is. But she was a trailblazing activist on the topics of gender, race, community, business, and entrepreneurship. On the cover photo, which is one I feel like I've seen most of my life at various points, she's pictured with Gloria Steinem, who she worked closely with for about 5 years. In her New York neighborhood, she created a high quality childcare center, which also offered job training, adult education classes, a youth action corps, housing assistance, and food resources. Lovett has written a couple of books that have been well received and are about history. If you're interested in learning about Dorothy Pittman Hughes, With Her Fist Raised comes out January 19th. All right. Ida B. The Queen, The Extraordinary Life and Legacy of Ida B. Wells. by Michelle Duster. This is, and I lost my page, that was my note. Okay. Wells was born enslaved in Mississippi. Sorry, she's dead now. She was born over 100 years ago. And she went on to become a journalist, co-founder of the NAACP, and a Pulitzer Prize winner, actually. She was also an anti-lynching crusader, which unfortunately was a thing that needed to exist. For all of her work at the time, the FBI labeled her a, and I quote, dangerous, and then the nicer N-word, agitator. But she is a civil rights icon. This book has been written by her great-granddaughter and is considered a loving tribute. But she feels reminds us of the transformative power of one determined woman. I think it looks interesting. And if you're interested in I to Be the Queen, it comes out January 26th. All right, so this is a subject I've read about at various points and has been discussed, I think, a fair amount in the last few decades. The adoption business. Oh, sorry. The book is American Baby, A Mother, A Child, and the Shadow History of Adoption by Gabrielle Glazer. So in post-war America, the adoption business was often secretive and had a tendency to lie to people. It's also described as lucrative, exploitative. They lied to adoptive parents about the origin of some of the children they were adopting. They struck unethical deals with doctors so that they could come up with pseudoscientific assessments of these babies. And they shamed numerous young women into signing away their parental rights. Glazer illuminates this story by focusing on one family and their sort of twin search for each other. In 1961, a 16-year-old girl named Margaret fell in love with a man that she would eventually marry and have all of her children with. But she became pregnant at that point at 16. So her family, who were unsupportive, sent her to a maternity home. The nurses there did not let her hold her baby after she gave birth, and they eventually badgered her into signing away her rights. The other side of the search is the young man who is looking for his birth family to eventually find out that he grew up a few blocks away from them. Glazer is a journalist and an author who often writes about health, culture, women's issues. Her other books have 3.5-star ratings on Goodreads. We don't have ratings for this one because, of course, it's a new book. But if you're interested in American Baby, it comes out January 26th. All right. Don't forget, if you would like to win either the other Bennett sister or the wrong Mr. Darcy, just write I want to win and your MPL location in the comments below. Our Goodreads group is growing strong and gaining people. I will continue adding reviews as I read new books. And if you guys want to start adding reviews, that would be great. Our newsletter, MPL Pre-Reads, is available at the link below. Also, the monthly nonfiction and fiction new books is also at that link. If you wanted to sign up for that, you can get the new book flyer sent right to your email. Next week, I will be doing January leftovers and something that's been requested a lot that I think I figured out how to incorporate. I'm going to give you a list of all of the audiobooks that are coming out that we've already pre-ordered for the books I've talked about, if that makes sense. So yes, we'll talk about January audiobooks as well. Our final thought of the day comes from Shanda Bloomberg. It says, library books are best enjoyed the night before their due date in a frantic rush to finish them because there is a hold and you can't renew. All right. Thank you for watching. I'll see you guys next week. Bye. Stop sharing. Yeah.